The Lays of Marie de France, translated with introduction and commentary by Edward J. Gallagher, read by Georgina Sutton and David Rintoul for Ukemi Audiobooks.
Introduction to The Lays of Marie de France by Edward Gallagher. The title of this audiobook immediately elicits two questions. First, what is a lay? And second, who was Marie de France? The answer to the second question is easy. No one knows who she was. In the brief prologue to the first of the 12 lays, the author gives her name simply as Marie. Hear, my lords, what Marie says, who does not wish to be forgotten in her time. It now does seem likely that the author of the lays lived in Anglo-Norman England and probably composed her lays after 1155 and before 1200. We now come to the first question. What is a lay? If Chrétien de Troyes' five romances and the two old French versions of the Tristan story constitute the medieval precursors of the modern novel, the lays can be considered the medieval antecedents of the modern short story. What is undeniable is Marie de France's place in literary history as the most accomplished writer of lays. At both the beginning and the end of each of her tales, Marie provides a mini-prologue and epilogue in which she speaks both of her source and describes what she has written, using terms like lay, adventure, tale, and story, but with no consistency. The term lay is quite a slippery one. On the one hand, among the Celts, it is believed that lay, perhaps from Old Irish laid, song, was first used to describe a non-vocal piece of music associated with a certain story. That story, which existed in oral but rarely written form, then also became known by that same term, lay, and was given the same title as the title of the piece of music. Marie de France heard these narrative Celtic lays, probably in French translation, and wanted to set them down in written form in order that they not be forgotten or lost. Just as these Breton narrative lays migrated from oral performance and oral transmission to written versions, the term lay attached itself to the works of Marie and of other authors too. While Marie herself at times does refer to her sources as lays, she more often uses terms like tale or story to refer to what she's writing. Yet the term lay has become, like the author's name itself, inextricably attached to all 12 narratives attributed to Marie de France. A totally satisfactory, succinct definition of the lay remains elusive. Marie's are narrative, as opposed to lyrical poems, written in rhyming, octosyllabic couplets. Each lay focuses on some extraordinary adventure, involving, in all cases, a problematic love relationship in chivalric society. The geographic setting is frequently, but not exclusively, Britain or continental Brittany. Magical or otherworldly elements play a significant role in fully half of the lays, yet the remaining six lays are quite realistic and devoid of these fey elements. If marvellous motifs, present in only half of the lays, do not furnish a unifying element to the entire collection, certainly the theme of love, found in all 12 lays, does fill that role. Yet even here, there are significant variations to be noted. The adulterous relationships of courtly lovers are extolled in at least five of Marie's lays, Guigemar, Yonec, Milin, Laustique, and Chèvrefeuille. Yet in only two of these, Guigemar and Milin, does this love triumph in the end. The unhappily married woman has been a typical figure in French love stories from medieval times to the present. Marie de France studies the situation of this type of woman at length in Guigemar and Yonec, for example. Young wives, cruelly sequestered and guarded by their much older, jealous husbands, find love with handsome young men, who manage to penetrate the confines in which these unhappy women are kept. Secrecy constitutes an essential element of these relationships, for discovery can easily lead to death. While Marie implicitly approves of adulterous love in Guigemar, Milin, Laustique, and Chèvrefeuille, one finds in Yonec the most audacious of any scene in all the lays, demonstrating her approbation of adultery. an unhappily married woman, in the seventh year of her imprisonment by her jealous husband, yearns for a love affair like those she has heard about in old tales of love. To fulfil her wishes, the bird knight enters through her window, but before beginning an affair with him, she insists that he prove his bona fides by swearing that he believes in God. So that he may receive communion, the knight has her call the old priest who guards her. The knight assumes the woman's appearance, and her chaplain enters her room to administer the Eucharistic bread and wine to the knight as a prelude to their adulterous liaison. Marie confirms here, and in a most striking way, her acceptance of one of the key tenets of courtly love, its complete independence from the moral code of the Church.
The Lays of Marie de France. Prologue. Anyone to whom God has given knowledge, along with fine, eloquent speech, ought neither keep that knowledge quiet nor hide it, but rather ought gladly demonstrate it. When a great good is heard widely, it immediately brings forth flowers, and when it is praised by many people, its flowers then open and bloom. According to the testimony of Priscian, the ancients believed that as for the books that they wrote with obscurities in them, those who were to follow them and who were to study them could add commentaries to what had been written down and establish their full meaning. Philosophers knew and understood intuitively that as time went by, people would have more subtle intellects and would be better able to interpret what was to be recovered in these books. Those who want to avoid vice ought to study and reflect and begin to compose weighty works. In this way they can avoid and keep themselves from great sorrow. For this reason, I began to think of some good tale to tell, transposing it from Latin into French. But this was hardly a praiseworthy endeavour, for others had undertaken the same project. I then recalled lays that I had heard. I well knew, and did not doubt, that people who first began to work on them and to promulgate them told them so that the adventures they had heard would be remembered. I have heard many of these lays, which I don't want to neglect or forget. I have composed them, and have spent many a sleepless night putting them into rhyme. In your honour, noble king, who are so valiant and courtly, to whom all joy inclines, in whose heart all good things take root, I undertook to gather these lays together, and to put them into rhyme, and to recount them. In my heart I thought and said to myself, sire, that I would present them to you. If it pleases you to receive them, you shall give me great joy, and because of this I shall be happy for ever. Do not take me for presumptuous if I dare to offer you this gift. Listen now to the beginning. 1. Guigemar. It weighs heavily upon the writer who works with good material if it is not handled well. Hear, my lords, what Marie says, who does not wish to be forgotten in her time. Those of whom people speak well ought to be praised. However, when there are men and women of good repute in a country, those who are envious of their good name often speak villainously of them. They want to devalue their renown. For this reason they assume the stance of a malicious, cowardly, and felonious dog who bites people out of treachery. If gossips or slanderers want to criticise me harshly, I in no way wish to abandon my work because of this. It's their right to speak ill of me. I will recount to you rather succinctly the tales that I know to be true, from which the Bretons made lays. Following this opening, I will tell you, according to the record and what has been set down in writing, an adventure that took place long ago in Brittany. At that time, Oel ruled this land, which was often at peace, often at war. The king had a baron who was lord over Lyon. He was named Oridial. He was much loved by his sovereign, and was a worthy and valiant knight. He and his wife had two children, a son and a beautiful daughter. The girl's name was Nogon. They named the boy Guigemar. There was none more handsome in the kingdom. His mother loved him deeply, and he got on marvellously with his father. When he was able to go off on his own, his father sent him to serve the king. The young man was worthy and wise, and for this reason he was loved by everyone. In due course, when he came of age and intellect, the king dubbed him a knight and richly endowed him, giving him all the equipment he wished for. Guigemar left court. Before going off, he gave many gifts. In order to seek fame, he went into Flanders, where there was always strife and warfare. At this time, one could not find such a good knight. There was not his equal in Lorraine or in Burgundy, in Anjou or in Gascony. Nature had made one mistake concerning him, for he never showed any interest in love. There was not a lady or a maiden under heaven, no matter how noble or beautiful, who would not have taken him as a lover if he had sought her love. Many women often sought his love, but he felt no such desire. No one who knew him could imagine that he wanted to experience love. For this reason, strangers, as well as his friends, considered him doomed. At the very zenith of his renown, this warrior knight returned to his own country in order to see his father and his lord, his good mother and his sister, who had longed to see him. As far as I know, he stayed with his family for an entire month. He felt an urge to go hunting. That night, he called upon his knights, his huntsmen, and his houndswains to assemble. In the morning, he went into the forest to hunt, for this sport pleased him a great deal. They set off after a large stag, and the dogs were let loose. The huntsman ran ahead, the young man tarrying behind. A valet carried his bow, his hunting sword, and led his hunting dog. If he had the opportunity, he wanted to use his bow before leaving the forest. In the densest part of a great thicket, he saw a doe and her fawn. This animal was completely white. It had a rack of antlers on its head. Because of the dog's barking, it bolted. Guigemar drew his bow and let fly an arrow at the doe. He struck the doe in the forehoof. It fell instantly. The arrow rebounded. It struck Guigemar in the thigh in such a way that it went clear through and struck the horse, so that Guigemar soon had to dismount. He fell to the ground onto the thick grass next to the doe that he had felled. The wounded doe moaned in agony. Then it spoke these words: "Ah, alas, I am dying. And you, vassal, who have wounded me, this is your destiny. May you never have a cure, neither from herbs nor roots, nor by potions, nor by a physician will you ever be cured of the wound you have in your thigh, until she cures you, who for love of you will suffer great pain and great sadness, such that no woman has ever suffered. And you will suffer the same for her, and all those who love, have loved, or will love in the future will marvel at this. Leave here. Leave me in peace." Guigemar was grievously wounded and overwhelmed by what he heard. He began to think about what country he might go to in order to have his wound cured, for he didn't wish to allow himself to die. He knew quite well, and was correct in thinking, that he had never met any woman to whom he would give his love, nor who would cure him of his pain. He called his valet to his side. "Friend," he said, "go in all haste, have my companions return, for I wish to speak to them." The valet hurried off, and Guigemar stayed where he was. He moaned in anguish. With his shirt pulled taut, he bound his wound tightly. He then mounted his horse and left that place. He was most anxious to be far from there. He wanted none of his people to come there, to dissuade or to detain him. He went through the woods along a verdant path, which led him out of the forest. On the plain, he saw a mountain cliff from which water flowed steeply down to the shore below. It was an arm of the sea. There was a harbour there. In the harbour, there was one solitary ship. Guigemar could see its mast. The ship was very well made, corked inside and out. No one could find a joint. There was not a peg or a rail that wasn't made entirely of ebony. There is no gilding under heaven that is more costly. The sail was entirely of silk. When unfurled, it was quite beautiful. The knight was very perplexed. Neither in the region nor in the country had he ever heard it said that ships could anchor here. He continued along and then dismounted. He went on board in great anguish. Where he thought he would find men charged with protecting the ship, there was none. He saw no one at all. In the middle of the ship, he discovered a bed, the posts and sides of which were, in the Solomonic style, of carved gold, and inlaid with cypress and white ivory. On top of the bed was a quilt of silk, with golden threads woven through it. I can't put a price on the other bedclothes, but I'll tell you this much about the pillow. Were you to lay your head on it, your hair would never turn white. The sable covers were lined with crimson cloth from Alexandria. Two candlesticks of pure gold, the lesser was worth a fortune, in which two candles burned, stood on the prow of the ship. He marvelled at all of this. He lay down on the bed to rest. His wound hurt. Then he got up. He wanted to leave. He could not. The ship was already on the high seas. It quickly sailed off with him. The weather was fine with a good wind. There was no going back. He was terribly sad. He didn't know what to do. It's no wonder he was distraught, for he felt excruciating pain from his wound. He had to endure this adventure. He prayed that God would take care of him, that by his omnipotence he would lead him to a harbour and preserve him from death. He lay down on the bed and fell asleep. That day he had come through the worst of it. Before nightfall, he will land in the place where he will find a cure, below an ancient city, which is the capital of this kingdom. The lord who ruled there was very old, and he had a wife, a lady of high birth, who was noble, refined, beautiful, and wise. He was exceedingly jealous, since by nature old men are jealous, and every one of them abhors the idea of being cuckolded. Such is the failing of old age. He did not take lightly the necessity of having his wife watched. In the garden, below the castle keep, there was a completely enclosed space. The wall was of green marble. It was very thick and high. There was but a single entry that was guarded night and day. The other side was blocked by the sea. If you had business at the castle, you could not enter or leave this place except by boat. In order to keep his wife secure, the king had had a room carved into the wall. There was none more beautiful under heaven. At the entrance was the chapel. There was a painting that went entirely around the room. Venus, the goddess of love, was prominent in the mural. She revealed the meaning and nature of love, and how people ought to embrace and serve love, both well and loyally. She is tossing Ovid's book, in which he teaches how to manipulate love, into a blazing fire, and she declares anathema all those who might ever read this book and follow its teachings. It was here that the wife was lodged and held. Her husband had given her a maidservant, who was loyal and well brought up. She was his niece, his sister's daughter. There was great affection between the two women. She would stay with the wife when the husband travelled. Until his return, no man or woman came there, nor did the wife go beyond these walls. An old priest, with white hair and a ruddy complexion, kept the key to the entry gate. He was completely impotent. Otherwise, he would not have been trusted. He said mass and served the wife at table. That very day, in the early afternoon, the wife went into the garden. She had napped after lunch, and so she went outside to relax in the sole company of her maid. They looked down toward the sea. They saw the ship that sailed into the harbour at high tide. They didn't see anyone at the helm. The lady wanted to turn away and flee. Her face was all red from fright. It's little wonder she was frightened. But the maid, who was wise and of stouter heart, comforted her and reassured her. They hurried in the direction of the ship. The maid removed her cloak and boarded the ship that was quite beautiful. She found no living creature aboard, save for the lone sleeping knight. She stopped and observed him. She saw that he was pale and thought he was dead. The maid turned back and quickly called her mistress. She told her the whole story, expressing great pity for the dead man she had seen. The lady replied, "Let's go see. If he is dead, we shall bury him. Our chaplain will help us. If I find that he's alive, he will speak to us." They went off together, without tarrying at all, the lady in front, the maid following. When she got aboard the ship, the lady stopped before the bed. She observed the knight. She grieved for his body and his beauty. She was sad and doleful for him, and said that he lost his youth in an evil hour. She placed her hand on his chest. It felt warm, and his strong heart was beating beneath his ribs. The knight, who had been sleeping, woke up and saw her. He was most pleased, and greeted her. He was sure he had reached land. The lady, distraught and in tears, answered him most courteously, and asked him how he had come, and from what land, and if he was in exile as a result of war. "Lady," he said, "no, that's not why. But if you would like me to, I will recount my story to you. I will keep nothing from you. I am from Brittany. Today I went hunting in the forest. I wounded a white doe, and the arrow rebounded. It struck me in the thigh, wounding me so severely that I feel I shall never regain my health. The doe cried out and spoke. It cursed me terribly, and then swore that I would find no cure except at the hands of a woman. I do not know where to find her. As soon as I heard my fate, I fled from the forest. I saw this ship in a harbour. I did something rash and came aboard. The ship set sail with me on board. I don't know where I've wound up or what the name of this city is. Fairest lady, I ask you, for God's sake, have pity on me and help me, for I don't know where to go. I cannot steer this ship." She answered him, "Dear, gentle sir, I shall gladly enlighten you. This city belongs to my husband, as does all the surrounding territory. He is powerful and of high birth, but extremely old. If truth be told, he is violently jealous. He has confined me to this prison. There is but one entry. The door is guarded by an old priest. May God grant that he burn in the fires of hell. I am sequestered here, night and day. I will never dare leave this place unless this priest orders it, or unless my husband asks for me. Here I have my room and my chapel, and this maiden with me. Should you care to stay until you are able to travel, we will gladly take you in, and it will be our pleasure to serve you." When he heard what she had to say, he thanked her most kindly, and said he would stay with her. He got up from the bed and stood upright. With some difficulty they helped him. The lady led him from there to her room. They laid him on the servant's bed in an alcove behind a drapery that hung in the room. They brought him water in a golden basin. They washed the wound on his thigh. With a cloth of fine white linen, they wiped all the blood away. Then they tightly bound the wound. They cherished the knight very much. When their evening meal arrived, the maid set some aside so that the knight would have enough to eat. He ate well and drank his full. But love had struck him a mortal blow. Already there was great strife in his heart, for the lady had so wounded him that he completely forgot his homeland. He felt no pain from his wound, but he sighed mightily with pain. He asked the maid, who was supposed to serve him, to let him sleep. Leaving him, she went off. Since he had given her leave, she went to her mistress, who was feeling ardour from the same fire that ignited and inflamed Guigemar's heart. The knight remained alone. He was anxious and distraught. He didn't yet know what all this meant. Nonetheless, he certainly understood that if he was not cured by this woman, his death was a sure and certain thing. "Woe is me," he said. "What am I to do? Shall I go to her, and shall I ask her to have pity and have mercy on this miserable wretch? If she refuses my request, and if she is haughty and full of pride, I shall have to die of grief, or forever languish with this sickness." Then he sighed. A little later, a different thought came to him, that it was necessary to suffer, for this was all that he could do. All night long he could not sleep. He sighed and suffered so. In his heart he kept remembering her words and her appearance, her sparkling eyes and her lovely mouth, the sweetness of which moved his heart. Inaudibly he begged her for mercy. He all but called her his beloved. Had he known how she felt, and how love was torturing her, it seems to me this would have made him quite happy. This little comfort would have somewhat eased the pain that gave him such a pallor. If he suffered because he loved her, she was in no way better off. The lady arose even before the break of dawn. She bemoaned the fact that she had been awake all night. This was the effect of love that was tormenting her. The maid, who was with her, knew from the lady's appearance that she was in love with the knight, who was staying in the room, waiting to recover. But she didn't know whether he loved the lady or not. The lady went into her chapel, and the maid went to where the knight was. She sat beside the bed. He spoke to her, saying this, "Friend, where has my lady gone? Why has she risen so early?" Then he fell silent, and he sighed. The maid spoke to him. "Sir," she said, "you are in love. Be careful not to hide it too much. You are able to love in such a way that your love will be well placed. He who would wish to love my mistress must have the highest regard for her. This love will be fitting if the two of you are steadfast. You are handsome, she is beautiful." He answered the girl, "I am stricken by such a love. I will certainly come to no good whatsoever if I do not receive help and aid. Advise me, dear sweet friend. What am I to do about this love?" With great tenderness, the maid comforted the knight and assured him of her help and of all the good offices she could offer. She was most kind and gentle. After the lady had heard mass, she returned, not wanting to be neglectful. She wanted to know what this man, whom her heart did not cease loving, was doing, if he was awake or asleep. The maid called her over and had her go to the knight. She will be quite able, at her leisure, to open up to him and speak her mind, whether it turns out well or badly for her. He greeted her, and she him. They were both quite agitated. He dared ask nothing of her. Since he was a foreigner, he was afraid that if he opened up to her, she would feel such hatred for him that she would send him away. But anyone who does not reveal weakness can scarcely expect to regain health. Love is a wound within the body, no evidence of which is seen on the outside. This is a sickness that lasts a long time, for it comes from nature. Many people consider it a jesting matter, just like those boorish courtiers who flirt everywhere, then boast of what they've done. This is not love, but folly and wickedness and lechery. Anyone who can find a loyal lover is to serve him and love him truly and do as he wishes. Guigemar was desperately in love. Either he will find an immediate cure, or he will have to live as a wretch. Love gave him courage. He revealed his desires to her. "Lady," he said, "I am dying for love of you, and so my heart is in great distress. If you do not deign to cure me, I will simply have to die. I ask you for your love. Fair lady, do not in the least refuse me. When she heard what he had to say, she answered him appropriately. Laughing, she said, Friend, any decision to grant your wish would be too hasty. I am hardly used to behaving in this way. Lady, he said, for God's sake have pity on me. Do not be angry if I say these things to you. A coquettish woman, who makes a practice of this kind of thing, insists on being pursued for a long while to make herself more desirable, so that a man will not think that she frequently grants this kind of pleasure. But a right-thinking woman, who is virtuous and sensible, if she finds a suitable man, will not be too haughty toward him, but she will love him and will take her pleasure with him before anyone knows about it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.